As we prepare to start worship here, can you guys please stand and help us sing this song?
Would you join together in our call to worship? Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord and call on his name.
Make known God's deeds among the peoples.
God blesses us with gifts of love.
With food and clothing, home and family.
God blesses us with daily work
and all we need from day to day.
God protects us in times of danger
and guards us from every evil.
God calls us into relationship with him
and forms us into one holy people, the Church of Jesus Christ in this place.
Therefore shall we offer thanks and praise to the Lord our God.
O Lord our God, we will give thanks to you forever.
Please pray with me. O God, who desires good for all creatures, satisfy our hunger not just for food, but for freedom, truth, justice, and love. O risen Christ, you revealed yourself to us as one who gives to the poor and cares for all people. We dedicate our lives and our offerings to your service. O Holy Spirit, bless these gifts and abide in our hearts, so that our gifts and our actions may live out our faith, glorify God, and bring forth a fruitful harvest for the kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I'd invite us to stand and we will sing together, Come Ye Thankful People Come.
seated. The first scripture reading comes from Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. The second reading comes from Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 through 40. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" The king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." This is the word of the Lord.
Well, we are gathered here this evening as a community of faith. Various denominations and doctrinal traditions brought together by one true God who has chosen us to be his holy and beloved people. As a community of faith, we have joined together in a variety of events and in a variety of things. As a ministerium over this past year, we've been responsible for sponsoring an organization, undertaking called the PB&J. Where we have come together to provide meals for our school children who have need. There is no greater act of thanksgiving than meeting the needs of another. In fact, God tells us in Matthew chapter 25 that when we do something like this, we serve Christ. Our final award is predicated on such acts, according to Matthew 25. For God says that if we do such things for the least of these, we do it for him. I like to think of the final judgment in some ways as the Thanksgiving awards. We have a lot of awards programs on television these days, don't we? And people talk about the things that they are given for something that they have done. And for many of them, they talk about it as if they earned it. And in some cases, those awards are given for people who have earned the right. But the Thanksgiving awards discussed in Matthew chapter 25 are not given because we earned them. They're given because the one who sits on the throne decides to give them. And those awards are given out of thanks for the things that we have done. Now, I had a friend who I'd known for quite some time, who was a Vietnam vet, Bill. And we went over to visit Bill and Bev one time for a holiday. Now, most of the time when we went to visit Bill and Bev, we sat in their kitchen and we played games and visited and talked. But this time we were going for a meal and we went down into his family room. And while I was wandering around, I was looking at the things that were hanging on the wall, and something caught my eye. It looked rather official. So I walked up, and here framed was a letter commending Bill for something he did in Vietnam. He had been awarded a Bronze Star. Now, you get a Bronze Star because you do something that probably you and I would consider crazy. You go in and you rescue somebody. And I thought, Bill, you had a Bronze Star? And then I looked, and next to it was another frame with another letter. He didn't have one, he had two. Two Bronze Stars given to him for acts of bravery. You know what he said to me? I was just doing my job. Those were not something he earned. They were something he was given in recognition. Now, the question we have here tonight is, what kind of people deserve that kind of recognition? And I think that the kind of people that deserve that recognition are described in the Colossians passage. You'll notice in the Colossians passage that it is full of words like thankfulness and gratitude. And so the awards talked about in Matthew 25 are given to people who have lived a life that has been prepared by thankfulness to do the things that God has called us to do. So I contend that the first thing we need to understand is the kinds of things that God calls us to put on. So if you look at this passage here we have in Colossians, you'll notice that there's a list of things. It says, put on, then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, which we are all holy and beloved to God, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgive each other, as the Lord has forgiven you. So you also must forgive. And above all these things, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. So we as Christians need to know that God expects us, if we're going to live a thankful life, to clothe ourselves in these things. Compassionate hearts, demonstrating a concern for other people. Kindness, showing kindness to those around us. That's what we do in the PB&J, for example. We're showing a kindness to someone who has a need. We're demonstrating compassion. We do this meekly. We don't do this in a bragging way. Most people will never know who it is who's contributed to that, or who it is that goes out to the food bank and packs the bags every month. No one really knows. The kids just get the things that they need. We do it with patience. One of the more difficult things to put on for most of us, right? To be patient. And we have to bear with one another and exercise a forgiving heart. We are human. We tend to have difficulties. And the Lord says, He forgave you, you should forgive others. But above all else, it says to put on love. And in the English Standard Version, which I'm reading from, it says, love binds everything together. Now, I don't know if you've ever visited the Slavic pottery shop up in near Grove City. But they have this incredibly intricate pottery. It's got all these flowers and leaves, and I mean, they have a video there showing you how it's done and how this person meticulously puts each thing on this thing, and the thing goes round and round and round, sort of like this first part of the passage. Each thing added and put on. And then the final thing is they take this beautifully decorated piece of pottery and they dunk it in something that completely covers everything and makes it white. And you go, you just ruined all that person's work. Until they put it in the kiln. And the kiln binds all those colors together and forms them up so that they cannot be taken off. Love is similar to that for the Christian. If we bind our life up in love, all of these other things that God says marks a life of thankfulness will be present. It says here that those who let peace, see this next verse, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. People who are anxious don't tend to be thankful. People who are at peace have the chance to look at their life and see the things that God has given and demonstrate thankfulness. If we're anxious about what we're going to have for a meal, how can we give to another? If we're anxious about what people will say to us, how can we say something nice about them? See, God says, let the peace of God govern your hearts and be thankful. The kind of people who are awarded in Matthew 25 are people who have learned to let the peace of God rule in their life. But that's not an easy thing to accomplish in this busy world that we live in. We fill our life with all manner of things, none of which helps us have peace. But here in the passage, it tells us how we can have that. It says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts towards God. Ladies and gentlemen, the first thing you need to know if you want to have the award at the end is that you have to have a life that is dressed properly. You have to have a life that is centered in the peace of Christ. And you have to do that, you have to be dwelling in the Word of God and letting the Word of God dwell in you. Now, you can't do that if you never open the book. But God says if we open the book and we study it and we meditate on it and we hide it in our hearts, we will not sin against God. We will instead live righteous lives. We will learn from one another. We will teach one another. Now I know, and I tell my people this at the church up there on the corner, that we often think that reads, the pastor teaches us. But it isn't. It's whoever dwells in the Word of God teaches another. We, by our example, teach one another. It's one of the reasons why Hebrews encourages us to get together, to encourage one another to love and good deeds. Hebrews tells us that we're to do that and not to forsake that, because it's important. And so we get together, we teach one another, because we allow the Word of God dwell in us richly. We can do that. And we can, when necessary, admonish one another. It's not always easy to continue a life of thankfulness. It's not always easy to be mindful of the things God has done. Until we get together and can share what Christ has been doing in your life and in my life. We gather from a variety, as I said, of churches here, a variety of traditions, a variety of doctrinal positions. But we all know one Savior. We all have one true God. And in His Word, He gives us the things that helps us live for Him and to admonish one another to continue to live in such a way as that we declare the glory of God. And as a matter of fact, it is the source of joy, you see. And that's why we sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. We sing them because we're grateful. Music, the musical tradition of the church is so important. And no less a time than it is at Thanksgiving. We come here and we lift up praises to the God who has provided all that we have. Everything that we own, everything that we possess, everything that we need has been given to us by the Father above. How can you not sing? How can you not proclaim the glory of God? How can you not do these things in thankfulness? These awards will be given to those who do everything in the name of Jesus, giving thanks. You see, that's what it says here at the end. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Whatever you do in word, hear my cries. I really need this, Lord. We have the gimmies, when in fact, he's given us everything we need. We should spend more time saying, thank you, God, so that it comes out when we talk to our neighbor, we talk to each other. Thankfulness in word comes before thankfulness in deed. But you'll notice that's what it says there at the end of the passage. It says to be thankful in deed as well. It is hard for people who think that they are getting something because they've earned it to be grateful. Grateful comes when we realize we get something we didn't deserve. That's the nature of all those people that are talked about in the Matthew passage. They stand before the Lord and he says, you've done all these things. And they're like, when? When did we do that? He said, you did it to this, and this, and this, and this. And whenever you did it to the least of these, you did it to me. It was the natural outworking of their faith. You see, they lived a life of such thankfulness, they had to minister to other people. Because our ministry grows out of a heart of gratitude to the Lord for what he's given to us. When we go out and proclaim the gospel, we don't proclaim it because it's our duty. We proclaim it because who wouldn't want to let someone else experience what we have? You see, I am so grateful for what God has done for me. I want you to have it too. I am so grateful for what God has given to me. I want to share it with you. It's not a reward. We didn't earn it. It's an award given because God chooses to do so. But he only gives it to those he deems deserving. And to be deserving, we need to live lives of thankfulness. May our thanksgiving be one of thankful service to those who God has sent our way. May we, as a community of faith, live thankful lives that treat the people around us as if they were Christ himself. May we prove to be worth the Thanksgiving award that God has promised. William Blake once wrote that the thankful receiver bears a plentiful harvest. If you want a plentiful harvest, then live thankfully.
By now, God, you would have reached down and wiped our Thank you. Thank you, Greg, and the praise group for your music. It's good to have you all here. John, thank you. Good sermon, great message. We're thankful for you in this community. One of the things that John talked about was the PB&J program, and that is part of a national backpack program for children, and you're going to hear more about that, but we thought we would introduce you to the backpack program through a video. So if we can get ready for that video up there in the booth.
I think it's stunning to think about the fact that the hope of our country, which are our children, really don't have enough food to learn well and to be productive and to grow into being healthy citizens.
We saw students who just could not concentrate and were not, they didn't have the energy, and they also didn't have that inner strength because, face it, food is fuel. You need good, healthy food for your brain to work well.
We feel like the backpack program is a natural solution and is one of those programs that really gets to the heart of the need, fills it, and provides increased access for kids when they need it most.
We all have a special place in our hearts for children. So the idea, the reality, that there are kids right now in the United States going to bed without food is unacceptable to us. So the backpack program is a very real way, a very tangible way, a very simple way of addressing that.
This time, her husband doesn't have as much work. They look forward for Friday to get this help. She really appreciates getting the coupons for milk and eggs for the kids.
We have something to look forward to when we come home.
Yeah.
And not embarrassed of not having a school snack. They've had that often.
I wait until my mom opens first and pick which food I like to eat and then wait for dinner and then eat it.
It helps me because my mom doesn't have no money and she can't buy food, so it helps me to get free food to eat.
We can't expect our kids to be positive, productive members of society if they're hungry, and we can fix that.
I don't think anybody understands, if you haven't experienced it yourself, the profound influence or impact you have on a child's life by not having enough to eat. A child never will forget that as long as they live. Going home and not having food on their table, or going to school and not having food in their stomach that morning. I don't think anybody understands the impact that has on a child's life if you haven't experienced it. They can never forget it. They live it every day of their life.
My name is Karen Wallace. I'm a retired teacher, and like you, I care about children. I know what a negative effect being hungry can have on a child who is trying to learn. I am part of the steering committee for our local food backpack program. The committee also includes Caitlin Struthers of Whitechapel Methodist Church and Lisa Hickman of New Wilmington Presbyterian Church. Our local food backpack program is called PB&J, which stands for Packing Backpacks and Joy. It's a cooperative venture of the Wilmington Area School District, the Community Food Warehouse of Mercer County, and the New Wilmington Ministerium, with Whitechapel Methodist Church as the nonprofit sponsor of PB&J. This program all began for us last November as an idea that developed from a Lawrence County Hunger Summit. People have stepped up to help out at every turn, sometimes when we didn't even know that we needed something. We're now up and running and have been delivering food for 9 weeks. There are currently 32 students receiving food each week. A food pack contains nutritious, shelf-stable, easy-to-prepare food for 2 breakfasts, 2 lunches, and 3 snacks. It costs about $300 per child to supply weekend food for the school year. 62 people, organized into 6 teams, including the fruit ladies, have volunteered to pack and deliver food to the schools each week. Add in the school personnel, secretaries, teachers, guidance counselors, who give so willingly of their time, ministerium members, the community food warehouse staff, and there are over 100 people in our community who are working on this effort. In fact, I see many of you out there right now. Lots of people agree, why should there be a hungry child in our school district if there's something I can do about it? People have given generously through churches, schools, and community organizations. Thank you so much for donating tonight's offering to PB&J. I will close with a quote from one of the teachers who distributes food. A little girl thanks me at least 3 times the day the food is handed out. And again, I say, thank you.
Thank you, Karen, for your leadership. It's been a blessed thing. She noted what is true, 100% of our offering tonight will go to PB&J, so give generously in the spirit of this season and in the manner of our Lord who teaches us to love our neighbor. And in the meantime, as we gather the offering, the handbell choir will offer their prayers as we worship. O Lord, accept our thanks and praise for all that you have done for us. We thank you for the splendor of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life, for the mystery of love. And above all, of course, we bless you for your Son, Jesus, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for his steadfast obedience by which he overcame temptation, for his dying through which he overcame death, and for his rising to life again in which we are raised to the life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit again that we may know him and make him known, and through him at all times and in all places that we may give thanks to you in all things. In his name we pray. Amen.
Almighty God, giver of all good things, we thank you for the natural majesty and beauty of this land. They restore us, though we often destroy them. We thank you for the great resources of this nation. They make us rich, though we often exploit them. We thank you for the men and women who have made this country strong. They are models for us, though we often fall short of them. We thank you for the torch of liberty, which has been lit in this land. It has drawn people from every nation, though we have often hidden from its light. We thank you for the faith we have inherited in all its rich variety. It sustains our life, though we have been faithless again and again. Help us, O Lord, to finish the good work here begun. Strengthen our efforts to blot out ignorance and prejudice, and to abolish poverty and crime, and hasten the day when all our people, with many voices in one united chorus, will glorify your holy name. Amen.
Now receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be kind and gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Hallelujah. Amen. Go in peace. Thanks be to God. Amen.